That is a question that I think depends a lot on the individual patient, which is probably true about everything we'll discuss here today, obviously. So we use gallium 68 PET depending on the clinical need. And what I mean by that is, let's say we have a patient who we will stage with the gallium 68 PET. And I think every patient in general deserves a gallium 68 PET initially, right, to show us where the extent of disease. So we know where all the disease is. It's in the liver, it's in the bone marrow, it's in the small bowel, it's in the lymph nodes. So we know where the disease is. Once we know where the disease is, we will then use a conventional imaging modality that's specific to that. So if it's in the lymph nodes, CT is the best to follow the patient. If it's in the liver, we'll follow it with an EVIST MRI. If it's in the bones, and that's the one odd circumstance, we'll typically follow then with a CT with intermittent gallium dotatate PETs, right? So the frequency of the gallium dotatate in that one unique setting is more frequent. Now, if you have disease in the liver and we're following with a liver MR, okay, and we are then, there's progression, stuff is growing, we then will decide if we need a dotatate PET, depending on whether or not you as an individual patient are being considered for PRRT. Does that make sense? So the dotatate PET is used pretty much at the time of whether or not we want to consider PRRT, peptide receptor radionuclide therapy, or if we're concerned that there's more progression than we're seeing on the dotatate PET. So to see whether or not there's osseous disease that's not being diagnosed on the liver MRI. And then in some patients, we'll get intermittent every couple years dotatate PETs just to make sure we're not missing a bigger picture change. But the conventional imaging is much better at looking for changes in size over time compared to dotatate PET. I don't know, it's a hard question to answer, but hopefully that helped out a little bit. That's a good question. It's sort of a hard question to answer in the sense that as a patient, I'm not sure how you would ever know this information before you get imaged. Most sites don't say my scanner is this type and it's this many years old and has these technological advances. So it's not like a widely appreciated fact, but technology does matter. And as new PET scanners are introduced, technology does improve. So as a first statement, I would say that gallium 68 dotatate is identical no matter where you are. So the imaging agent, the radiopharmaceutical, will be the same no matter where you're imaged. So it doesn't matter from the injectable. The radioactive agent you're getting is going to be identical everywhere. Now, the scanner does differ, obviously, between sites. And so there's been many technological advances over the years, going from non-time-of-flight to time-of-flight scanners. And then there's different things you can do in terms of reconstruction parameters, and then also the way you acquire the image, how long you image for, et cetera, can actually make a difference. Most centers nowadays, I would say, use time-of-flight scanners and use 3 minutes of imaging per bed. This is maybe too specific. If you have that in general, the diagnostic ability will remain equivalent across the majority of sites. That being said, you know, the majority of patients, this doesn't make a huge difference in. And what I mean by that is the detection ability of your scanner is for very small sites of metastases. And so what you're looking for, if you're a patient who has no evidence of disease, you might be able to see a very, very small site of disease that you couldn't see with a different scanner, but typically that doesn't make a clinical difference. In general, we assume that patients who have no evidence of disease after surgical resection or treatment will recur. The rate of recurrence is about 100% over about 10 years. It's just, when will that recurrence occur? So detecting that recurrence super early on by detecting a little site of disease shouldn't make a big difference in the management of the individual patient. And what I mean by that is you shouldn't be getting surgery to treat this or get systemic therapy. You should just wait over time, see how fast your disease is growing, and talk with your oncologist about the best way to manage that site of disease. So although there is detectability differences, and I study that and I look at that, from an individual patient perspective, what you really want to know is bulkiness of disease, how much of it there is, to try to determine whether or not you should get surgery or get PRRT. And those decisions are made based on larger metastases, which should be easily detected using whatever PET scanner is at your site. I hope that answers that question. So There are lots of documents and papers we've written to support the use of DOTATATE PET, or even in general, I would say somatostatin or receptor PET. One thing you have to remember is DOTATOC was approved a couple weeks ago, so that's now FDA approved. So for example, NCCN guidelines endorses the use of DOTATATE PET. We wrote an appropriate use criteria that was published in 2017 delineating when DOTATATE PET should be used. And the motive for doing that was to use it to provide a resource to provide to insurance companies. So I think those two guideline documents can be provided to insurance companies. Now, the way the end of that question was phrased, which was my insurance company denied it this year, suggests I had one last year or the year before. And I think that gets down to how frequently you should have a DOTATATE PET. And so you don't need to get a DOTATATE PET every year or something like that. And so unless you have a clinical need for the DOTATATE PET, which is in our AUC, we wrote out, you know, 9 different clinical indications and times where you should consider using DOTATATE PET, then that's why we wrote that document, to provide ammunition for you to go to your insurance company and say, hey, I fit indication 9 here, and it clearly states that, you know, in this circumstance, I should be able to get a DOTATATE PET. That's the general idea. But, you know, every insurance company is different and they push back differently, and it's very hard to give a blanket statement that this is how you get your insurance company to pay for it. But I think over time, this has become much easier than it used to be. I would say 3 years ago, this was actually really a big issue, and it's becoming less of a problem over time.
And where did those documents live again?
Ooh, that's a good question. So NCCN guidelines, those, if you go to nccn.org, there's a website, and you just type NCCN and neuroendocrine tumor into Google, it'll take you to their documents, and so you can register. It's a PDF, it's like 100 and some page long PDF, and in there, it recommends DOTATATE PET and DOTATOC PET. And then the AUC for SNMMI, so again, if you type in maybe my name, AUC SNMI, that lives on the SNMI website. That's a good question. So in general, insurance companies don't pay for second readings. That's not always true, but I'd say it's a general true statement. So the question is, if you got a formal read and you are doubtful of it, or you think there's a mistake, how would you go about doing that? So I think the best way to do it is probably to ask your oncologist. So most oncologists work in a hospital system of some sort, and there are radiologists who work in that hospital system. So the oncologist could request that the radiologist they work with go back and reinterpret or read it. So for example, here at UCSF, and this is not an uncommon thing, we have a neuroendocrine tumor board, and we can provide formal reads to reinterpret outside studies that are reviewed at UCSF. And I'm assuming the majority of centers that have neuroendocrine tumor boards can do the same. So that's, I'd say, the two ways to do it. So through a tumor board, and if you are concerned, I think having your case reviewed at a neuroendocrine-specific tumor board is really an important thing for you to do, and I'm sure many people have come on this streaming thing and talked about the role of a multidisciplinary tumor board, and I think that's a great environment through which to get second opinions on imaging reads. Yeah, so if you get diagnosed with a neuroendocrine tumor and you've had a CT or an MR, and your surgeon takes out your primary tumor and you have some lymph nodes and they're taken out, and then you're after surgery 3 to 6 months later and you never had a gallium-68 PET, you should definitely have a gallium-68 PET at that time. I think it's very helpful for your treating oncologist to know the extent of disease and where it is, and that again is approved in our appropriate use criteria. So if your insurance company is giving you a problem, I think that document can be helpful for that. If you had a gallium-68 DOTATATE PET before surgery, then you have surgery, you know where your disease is or isn't. I'm not sure there's a rule for repeating the somatostatin receptor PET soon thereafter. So you might consider repeating it a couple years later. If you know where your disease is, you can follow it with conventional imaging. And then if there's suspicion of progression, then you can consider repeating a DOTATATE PET. But you don't need one immediately after if you've already had a DOTATATE PET. Well, I think we're now hopefully in an era where the octreoscan doesn't exist, although I would love to know, I can see your comments show up. So if you don't have DOTATATE or DOTATATE PET available in your area, just make a call because I'd love to know how many people actually don't have access to somatostatin receptor PET. But historically, and we should couch it in historical phrases now, the octreoscan is the original version of imaging of the somatostatin receptor. So the octreoscan, is, in essence, is you take octreotide, which again was used for symptomatic control of neuroendocrine tumors, hormonal secretions that would decrease that. You label, in essence, octreotide with indium-111. Indium is a type of radionuclide, an atom, that decays by giving off, in this case, photons, and you can image the photons using a SPECT CT. So the main differences between octreotide and DOTATATE are based on the type of energy it gives off, which in this case is gamma photons, versus DOTATATE PET, which gallium-68 gives off a positron. And because of the differences in energies, you use a different type of technology to image it. And so gallium-68 DOTATATE is imaged using a PET CT or a PET scanner, and a PET scanner has very good sensitivity. So it's much better than a SPECT CT at detecting where disease is. So these aren't things that most people think about, but the technology itself really does impact the image quality. And so that results in some significant differences between the two imaging. So DOTATATE PET has better sensitivity, it sees smaller lesions better, and has a much better ability to see osseous disease, for example. It also has the ability to quantitate the uptakes, actually measure how much of the dose goes there. It has a lower radiation dose, and I think maybe the single biggest and most important benefit is that DOTATATE PET is imaged 1 hour after injection versus the next day for an octreoscan. So if you're a patient, you get your injection, you start your imaging 1 hour later, and then you're done an hour afterwards. Whereas with an octreoscan, oftentimes patients would come back the next day, then you get imaging with a SPECT CT, and then even some patients have to come back a day later, depending on if there's uptake in the colon. So it could be a multi-day, three-day imaging study, which can obviously be very impactful in terms of missing work and, you know, radiation exposure to people around you. So the DOTATATE PET, even if it were equivalent to an octreoscan in its ability to find tumors, it would still be preferred due to the ease of implementing the test, having it done in 2 hours. But it does actually have markedly better detection sensitivity for metastatic disease compared to octreoscan. That's a good question. So, blood work can be used to determine if there's elevation in hormones, right? So if you have diarrhea and you haven't been diagnosed with neuroendocrine tumor, your treating physician, you might not have an oncologist yet, right? So your general practice physician or maybe an endocrinologist, whomever is a gastroenterologist, will be working up your diarrhea and could, for example, secrete a serotonin level or a chromogram level or a VIP level to see if that's the cause of your diarrhea. Now, neuroendocrine tumors aren't the only reason you can have an elevated serotonin, right? So your urine 5-HIA may be elevated, but that does not mean you definitively have a neuroendocrine tumor. So if you have diarrhea and you have a high serotonin level, likely your diarrhea may be caused by the high serotonin level. That, again, doesn't mean you have a neuroendocrine tumor. And so at that time, I think a gallium-68 DOTATATE PET is a reasonable option. Now, I will say in patients who have biochemical evidence of neuroendocrine tumor, but negative CTs and MR, the chance of catching a tumor on gallium-68 DOTATATE PET is something like 10%, so it's very unlikely. But in our appropriate use criteria, we recommended DOTATATE PET in that setting, not because we think it's a good test, but because it's the best test and will hopefully put an end to looking for neuroendocrine tumor as the cause. Mm-hmm. So a lot of patients will routinely and for years try to find this unknown neuroendocrine tumor that's causing their elevated hormones. And I think a gallium-68 somatostatin receptor PET can hopefully put an end to that search.